ونستعينه ونستغفره. We praise him, we thank him, we ask him for his forgiveness. ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا وسيئات أعمالنا. We seek refuge in Allah from the evil of our sins. We seek refuge in Allah from the evil of our sins and the consequences and their evil consequences. May يهدي الله فلا مضل له. Whomsoever Allah guides, no one can lead astray. وَمَن يُضْلِلْ فَلَا هَادِيَ لَهُ. Whomsoever Allah leads astray, no one can guide. وَأَشْهَدُ أَن لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهُ وَحْدَهُ لَا شَرِيكَ لَهُ. I testify that there is no God worthy of worship except Allah, and He has no partners. وَأَشْهَدُ أَنَّ مُحَمَّدًا عَبْدُهُ وَرَسُولُهُ صلى الله عليه وسلم. I testify that Muhammad is a slave and final messenger. May Allah send His peace and blessings upon him, his family, his companions, and all those who follow him until the last day. قال الله تعالى, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا أَيُّهُ بَلِيبْ اِتَّقَ اللَّهَ حَقَّ تُقَاتِهِ. Fear Allah, be conscious of Allah in the way He deserves for you to be conscious of Him, in the way He deserves for you to fear Him. وَلَا تَمُوتُنَّ إِلَّا وَأَنْتُ مُسْلِمُونَ. And die only in a state of full submission to Him. يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا أَيُّهُ بَلِيبْ اِتَّقَ اللَّهَ وَقُولُوا قَوْلًا سَدِيدًا. Fear Allah, be conscious of Allah, and always speak the truth. يُسْلِحْ لَكُمْ أَعْمَالَكُمْ وَيَغْفِرْ لَكُمْ ذَنُوبَكُمْ. He will forgive you for your sins, and He will guide you to righteous deeds. وَمَنْ يُطِعِ اللَّهَ وَرَسُولَهُ فَقَدْ فَازَ فَوْزًا عَظِيمًا. Whoever obeys Allah and His Messenger has achieved the highest of achievements. You know, one of the most spine-chilling sights you can ever see, one of the most humbling actions you can ever do in your life, one of the most goosebump-giving experiences you can ever have, is attending the janazah of a parrot, is seeing a mother or father being buried by their own children. And in that moment, you see the epitome of human grief. You see the epitome of sadness, of loss, of trauma. You see the kids on the ground crying their eyes out, and sobbing and weeping, and sometimes they don't have the willpower to stand, and they need someone to carry them. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says about يوم القيامة in Surah Abasa, يوم يفر المرء من أخيه. The day that people will run away from their own siblings, وأمه وأبيه, and from their own mother and father, and then he says, وصاحبته وبنيه, and from their spouse and from their children. There is a purpose, there is a reason why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions this particular order. There's the Mufassirun, they comment about this and they say that this is the natural hierarchy of the human heart. In this life, you're attached to your kids the most. You love your kids, your offspring the most, and then comes your spouse, and then comes your mother and your father, and then comes your siblings. Right, by default, that's the natural hierarchy of the human heart. So the loss of anyone on that list, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave us, is extremely traumatic, is extremely difficult to bear, is extremely painful for any human being to go through. Now why I mention this, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he experienced two losses the same exact year. He lost his uncle Abu Talib, who was like a father figure to him, and his wife Khadija radiallahu anha. He took such a huge hit, such a huge emotional blow. And to add to it, the Prophet ﷺ did not have friends comforting him. The Prophet ﷺ did not have his community comforting him. The Prophet ﷺ, to add to all of that, instead he was tortured mentally and physically by his own people. And this then became known as Am al-Huzn, the year of grief, or the year of sorrow. And in this year, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He revealed Surah Yusuf as a means of comfort, as a means of consolation for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Meaning, anyone going through hardship, anyone going through troubles in your personal life, Surah Yusuf is a place you look for solutions, for guidance, for comfort. And there's one theme that occurs a lot in the surah, and that's family. The importance of building family, the importance of knowing how to reconcile between people, the importance of emotional intelligence, the importance of chastity, the importance of loyalty, the importance of exposing your kids to leadership and teaching them how to deal with people, how to deal with real life situations. And what's really mind-blowing is that the year that Surah Yusuf was revealed, right? The year that the Prophet ﷺ lost his uncle and his wife, the same year Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reveals Surah Yusuf, which is about another prophet who lost his family at a young age. So it's very interesting, the timing of the surah and then what's actually revealed in the surah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala begins the surah and he says, نَحْنُ نَقُصُّ عَلَيْكَ أَحْسَنَ الْقَصَصِ. The word نَقُصُّ means to tell something that actually happened. Meaning this isn't fabricated, this isn't a fairy tale, this isn't just a story for entertainment, this actually happened. This is a true story. And history rhymes, and if you don't study history, you're going to repeat the same mistakes. You want to learn the lessons from history so you don't repeat the same mistakes. The opening scene, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala jumps straight into a conversation between Yusuf alayhi salam, who at the time was 8 to 10 years old. According to Mufassirun, he was an 8-10 year old kid. And he has a conversation with his father, Yaqub alayhi salam, and he tells him, he says, Ya Abati, O my father. Now notice, he didn't say Ya Abi. It's another way to say my father in Arabic. He says Ya Abati, which indicates respect and politeness. Point number one, to access, and this is for the younger people in the audience, to access the hearts of your father is to show respect. Addressing parents in a respectful manner is a really good way to start a very serious conversation where you want the full attention and you want the full time of your parents. Today, family counselors all around the country write books about this and talk about this, how especially men in the family need to feel respected, let alone the parents. They need to feel respected. Kids, when they respect their parents, that opens the doors for the parents to show love to the kids and lend them an open ear to hear them out. So he says, Ya Abati, إِنِّي رَأَيْتُ أَحَدَ عَشَرَ قَوْكَبًا وَالشَّمْسَ وَالْقَمَرَ رَأَيْتَهُمْ لِسَاجِدِينَ. Oh my father, I had a dream and I saw 11 stars and the sun and the moon and I saw them prostrating to me. Now hold on a second. 11 stars and the sun and the moon and they're prostrating to you? How is the sun supposed to prostrate to a human being? Wait, this doesn't make any sense. It's a very bizarre, very weird image, right? It's very strange and it grabs your attention. Here we learn another point. Prophet Yusuf alayhi salam, he trusts his father, which is why he's telling him of this very crazy and bizarre dream. I mean, can you imagine going to your parents and telling them something very weird about yourself, something that's not normal about yourself, and your parents are like, oh my god, my kid's a total weirdo. But here, Yusuf alayhi salam, you know, he has such a strong bond with his father that he's not scared to tell him about his own personal dreams, even if they're very bizarre, even if they're very weird. And parents need to foster that trust with their kids. You know, it's a two-way deal. You can't just expect your kids to just trust you. You cannot expect your kids to just be open with you. These days, kids don't even want to tell you where they are. You know, your mom calls you, you never pick up. Your dad asks you where you were, and you beat around the bush. You don't really tell him where you were. Right? Kids, you know, parents have to foster that trust. It doesn't come automatically, especially with today's generation. It's not going to come automatically. The parents have to foster it. They have to give them safe space to talk about anything they want without feeling judged. And you know, it can be argued that one of the reasons why young Muslims are leaving the deen, one of the reasons why young Muslims don't want to practice Islam, is because they don't receive safe space at home. They don't receive the emotional need at home. Their parents do not fulfill that emotional void that they have. And it can be argued that one of the reasons why young Muslims are involved in promiscuous activities, you know, dating, haram relationships, filth on the internet, exposure on social media, is because their parents don't listen to them. It's because they don't have a safe outlet at home to talk about their needs and their wants and their desires. And so naturally as human beings, they turn to other venues, even if those venues are against the very teachings and morals that they were raised with. So there's one chef in particular, and he does something really beautiful with his kids. Chef Walid Busuni, he allows his kids privacy, meaning he's not going to go around and stick his nose in their phones and try to spy on his kids. But he has one rule around the house, and that is there's no secrets. His kids are open to talk to him about anything they want. Anything that comes to their mind, his kids can talk to him about. Another chef, Chef Yasser Birjaz, he shared with us when his kids make a mistake, when his son or his daughter comes to him and he said, you know, we made a mistake, and it could be a very big mistake. Instead of acting like a father and reprimanding them, what he does is he acts like a counselor. And he tries to counsel them. And he tries to help them not go back into that same mistake, into that same error that they were in. So point being, there's work involved. You have to nurture that environment to yourself. It doesn't come automatically. Just like money, just like your rizq, Allah provides for you your rizq. Allah is the one who wrote it for you. Allah is the one who facilitated it for you. But you and I have to go out and find it. You and I have to go out and work for it. Whether it's through a paycheck, whether it's through a business, whether it's through investment, whatever it might be, Allah is the one providing, but you and I have to put an effort to make it happen. Same thing for kids. You ask Allah for righteous kids. You ask Allah for a healthy family. You ask Allah for kids that are on the deen. But Allah will provide them, but you have to put in the work. The parents have to put in the work for that to happen. The tarbiyah has to happen at home. It cannot be left onto the masjid or the khatib or Jummah khutbah or the teachers in Islamic schools. That cannot happen. It starts all at home. The tarbiyah starts at home. Unfortunately, some of the cultures that exist in Muslim lands today, and this is where you need to separate Islam from culture, is that in some cultures, the reality is parents are very harsh and very rough with their kids. The reality is that men, especially men in some cultures, they're just nurtured to be very rough, very tough, very harsh. It's very hard, to the point that you can't even have a decent conversation with them. To the point that you never even see them smile. And what's interesting is that the Prophet himself faced this very issue. We all know the story very well, where he reprimanded a man in open public. We all know the story very well. A man came to the Prophet ﷺ and said, Ya Rasulullah, I have five kids. Don't quote me. I forgot the number of kids, but he said, I have a number of kids and I never kissed them in my life. And the Prophet ﷺ told the man, again in open public, what can I do if Allah has taken mercy out of your heart? In other words, this is a culture that the Prophet ﷺ did not accept. The Prophet ﷺ, in so many examples we see that, I don't have to quote, but so many examples where he showed so much mercy, so much compassion to kids, whether it's his own grandkids or whether it's other kids that he would see. Fatima radiyallahu anha and Ali radiyallahu anhu, they got into a dispute once. You know, just a normal husband-wife, you know, kind of thing, right? And the Prophet ﷺ wasn't nosy about it, even though he's a father-in-law, right? He tried to help out. He tried to give safe space, he tried to talk to Fatima, but she didn't want to talk. So he went to Ali radiallahu anhu, and as a father figure, he reconciled between them without getting into their business. You know, this type of relationship, unfortunately, is very hard to see in the Muslim community today, right? Today, it's I don't mean to be pessimistic, but the reality is that, you know, we see that we're in so many houses, the in-laws are just at war with each other. The daughter-in-law hates the mother-in-law. The mother-in-law hates the daughter-in-law. You know, so on and so forth. The husband is sick and tired of the wife nagging and complaining. The wife is sick and tired of the husband never giving her time or giving her an open ear. The mother is sick and tired of the kids just being a total mess. Right? It's a lot of times our families can end up being a total mess. And the thing is, it's okay. That's human. It's okay to make mistakes. It's okay to have a mess in your house. But what's not okay is that we claim to be a people who follow a man, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, whose house was peaceful. Yet we're okay. What's not okay is that we accept this as the standard. We accept this as the norm. That the house, the family is just, the house is just, is at war with each other. That the family, there's no peace in the family. Yet, you know, yet we claim to follow a man sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, whose wife Khadija radiallahu anha, Jibreel alayhi sallam, once came to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and said, Khadija is on her way, she's bringing some food for you. Tell her that Allah is giving her his salam and I am giving her my salam. To the point that Khadija radiallahu anha was promised a special place in Jannah because of who she was, because of the environment that she set in her house, because of the peaceful home that her and the Prophet ﷺ established for their kids. So, you know, whatever is happening in your life, whatever is going on, even in your personal families, right? The seerah is not fairy tales. You have to understand this. The seerah is not just entertainment story time. The seerah is not just stories that, you know, we listen and we cry about and we get happy about, we get a mad boost, and then as soon as we walk out the masjid, we forget about it. The seerah is a guide. A guide from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to how to live your own life, how to solve your own problems. Hence, it's important to dig deep into the Quran and the life of the Prophet ﷺ and seek out the solutions to your own personal problems. Now, back to the story of Yusuf ﷺ. How many times have you had a conversation with a 10-year-old? How seriously do you take a 10-year-old? A 10-year-old kid, like, a 10-year-old kid comes to you and talks to you and just starts talking about his personal dreams. How seriously do you take a 10-year-old? In reality, you don't, right? Parents may simply ignore their kids, or just give their kids something to play with, or just give their kids some distraction to just, you know, keep them busy, so they leave the parents alone. But in this case, his father, Yaqub alayhi salam, he says, Ya Bunayya. Now notice, he could have said, Ya Ibni, he could have said, My son. But he said, Ya Bunayya. Ya Bunayya roughly translates to, Oh my little son. It's a way of showing love and kindness. Point number three. We learn here, when children give their parents respect, parents then naturally reciprocate love to the child. And so if you want to access the heart of your parents, respect is how you do it. Respect is the key, especially to the father, especially to the male figure in the house. Respect is the key of how to open up doors to conversations, how to open up doors for it, for compassion. Prophet Yaqub alayhi salam, now in this case, Yaqub alayhi salam is a prophet. And he knew upon hearing this dream that Yusuf alayhi salam had, that it means something, it's special. Yaqub alayhi salam, he has a number of sons. Yusuf alayhi salam is his youngest son. And the first stage of revelation are dreams. So Yaqub alayhi salam, he knew that this dream wasn't just random, it actually meant something. It means that Yusuf alayhi salam is going to start. His journey is going to start. He's going to be a prophet. And this is the first sign. So, He tells us something very important. He actually warns Yusuf alayhi salam to not share the dream with his brothers, or else they will make a plot against him. He says, لَا تَقْصُصْ رُؤِيَاكَ عَلَى إِخْوَتِكَ فَيَكِيدُونَكَ كَيْدًا. Do not tell your brothers about your dream, or else they will plot against you. Point number four. You don't go around telling people things before they're final. Yusuf alayhi salam just started. Kind of, you know, the prophethood is kind of starting out, but it's not final. You don't go around telling people things about your life before it's final. It's so tempting to post on Facebook. It's so tempting to tell people about your accomplishments. It's so tempting. Because as human beings, we want other people to share our happiness. We want to celebrate. We want other people to be happy with us. We want people to give us likes on Facebook. We want people to share our joy and our accomplishments. But here, Yaqub alayhi salam, he said, it's very interesting what he says. It's important to avoid it. Because he says next, إِنَّ الشَّيْطَانَ لِلْإِنسَانِ عَدُوٌ مُبِينٌ. Shaytan is to you and I an open enemy. See, Shaytan is the ultimate root of all family problems. Shaytan, you know, his goal obviously is to destroy societies, to destroy you and I, to make sure we go to hellfire. That's his job. That's his bread and butter. That's what he does every day. That's why he wakes up. That's why, you know, he lives, to make sure you and I go down the wrong path. And if you want to destroy a society, you start with the family system. You destroy a society by destroying the family system. Once you tear apart families, you slowly begin to degrade the society. You know, mental illnesses, drugs, crime, fornication, poverty. It all spreads, it all starts where? At the family. You tear apart the family system and society slowly with time begins to degrade. According to the 2000 US Census, nearly half of all marriages end up in divorce. And that's not news for anyone here. The number of single mothers increased from 3 million to 10 million between 1970 and 2000. According to the National Commission of Children, more than 1 million kids experience a divorce, experience their parents divorcing and separating every single year. It's an epidemic. It's a total epidemic. In this country and now even in Muslim countries. The Prophet ﷺ told us that Shaytan celebrates. Shaytan gets so happy when he breaks apart a family. When a divorce happens, Shaytan celebrates. He gets so happy, he actually rewards, you know, the Shaytan that caused the issue between the husband and wife. That's how happy he gets.
You're just sowing jealousy, enmity, grudges. That's his bread and butter. That's what he likes to do. That's his goal. Here, Shaytan, in our case, will whisper and convince the brothers of Yusuf alayhi salam that their father is being unjust. Now, you know what? Yusuf alayhi salam is the youngest child, so, you know, our dad is playing favorites here. Our dad is playing favorites. He's going to be the next prophet because, you know what? He's the youngest one. Our dad loves him the most. But you see, Yaqub alayhi salam is never unjust. Yaqub alayhi salam treated all of his kids justly. And to love one kid more than another, that's an emotion. You cannot control emotions. You're not held accountable for that. What you are held accountable for is the way you act towards your kids. If you give one kid something, you have to give the other kid something of the same value. You have to be just. And Yaqub alayhi salam was just. But, see, when people believe there's injustice, they rebel and they go against the rules. That's human nature. Human nature. When people think that there's injustice happening, when people think that you're treating them unjustly, they will rebel against you. Be it your own sons, be it your own daughters. They will rebel against you if they think you're being unjust to them. So here we learn that Shaytan can arouse emotions in us. Shaytan has that power, even though he is weak, but he has the capability of arousing emotions in us. And in this case, jealousy. Right? Which, if we don't control, can make us act very irrationally, can make us think very irrationally. And Shaytan works hard to separate families. He's a common enemy, common enemy. So next time you have a heated argument with a family member, next time you get into a fight with a sibling or a spouse or a parent, or next time you get into a discussion with your child and you're both very heated, just take a little pause, step back, and really think about who's causing the fire. You see, our mistakes as human beings, that's the fuel. But Shaytan is one who sparks the flame. Shaytan is one who whispers into your ears and sparks the flame that caused the fires. Now, obviously because of time, you cannot continue. But the main point is that family should be a priority for every single one of us here. And we need to be a people who build or rebuild family. If you're in a situation where you're not talking to family members, and I know it's very difficult. I'm not going to pretend it's easy. It's very difficult, right? Some family members, Allah is that, they just don't want to listen, right? We all have those kind of situations in our families. But the point being is we have to put in the effort. We have to be a people who are family-oriented, who build or rebuild families. The Prophet ﷺ, the last point. Now, put yourselves in the shoes of the Prophet ﷺ. You're the last Prophet of Allah. You're the last Messenger of Allah. You know that there's time until Yawm al-Qiyamah. You know that there's going to be millions and millions of people to come after you. And you have one chance, one opportunity to give one last message to your people. What would you say? The Prophet ﷺ, in his last message, one of the things he said he ordered the men to treat women kindly, i.e. be good to your family. It was one of the last things the Prophet ﷺ emphasized, to be good to your family, to build family, to rebuild family. And if, in all honesty, if you want to be a community that survives the onslaught of all the things that are happening, if you want our younger generation to continue to be on the deen, we have to be a people who give them their safe space. We have to be a people who believe that there's khair in the next generation and don't just, you know, neglect them. Don't just throw them to the side. Don't just think that, you know, they're a second, they're not a priority for you. They are a priority. And to summarize, Yusuf alayhi salam showed respect to his father, and Yaqub alayhi salam in reciprocation showed love to his son. And that is the natural default of human beings. That is how kids can access the heart of their parents, and that's how parents can access the mind of their kids. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us of those who are family oriented, to make us of those who build and rebuild families. أَقُولُ قُلِ هَذَا وَاسْتَغْفِرُ اللَّهُ لَكُمْ فَاسْتَغْفِرُوا. بسم الله والحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله. So, since it is the month of Muharram, just a quick kind of reminder about Muharram. So Muharram is considered, it's the first month of the Hijri calendar, right? And it's actually considered the month of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's actually one of the sacred months of Allah. And in this month, actually, sinning is actually even more severe. So, you know, sinning is severe in general, right? But if you do a sin if you do a bad deed, especially in this month, it's even more severe. Vice versa, if you do good deeds in this month, it's even more beneficial for you. It's even better, and it's more pleasing to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And one thing I want to touch upon is fasting on the day of Ashura, the 10th of Muharram. The Prophet ﷺ, he inquired about... So in Medina, as we all know, different tribes were there with the Muslims, right? Including Bani Israel. There were Jewish tribes around Medina, right? So they would fast on the day of Ashura. They would fast on the 10th of Muharram, right? The Prophet ﷺ once inquired about why they're fasting on that day. And he said, it's the day that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala saved us from Fir'aun. It's the day that, as we know, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala saved Musa alayhi salam and his people and drowned the Pharaoh behind them. So, you know, we have a greater right over Musa than Bani Israel. Because of that, the Prophet ﷺ commanded the companions to fast on that day. But later on, it became optional. But the Prophet ﷺ also said that he hopes that this fasting on that day will erase all the sins of the previous year, all of the minor sins. So that is the reward of fasting on that day, the 10th of Muharram. So the 9th of Muharram is next Wednesday, the 10th is next Thursday. So try your best to make a reminder on your phone, on whatever reminds you to fast on those days. Because again, fasting on the day of Ashura erases all the sins of the previous year, the minor sins, at least, of the previous year. And the reason we fast is because of this hadith, because of the Prophet ﷺ saying that this will erase the sins of the previous year, and we as Ummah have a greater right over Musa than Bani Israel, and that's why we fast on this day. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to forgive us all of our sins, all of our shortcomings, all of our misdeeds. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to kindle love and respect between our families, between our parents, and between our children. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us of those who follow the Prophet ﷺ and his family members as role models, and to not just make them characters of entertainment. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to gather us as he has gathered us here in the highest levels of paradise with Yusuf alayhi salam, with Yaqub, with Rasulullah. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to forgive us for all of our shortcomings and errors. Any good in this was from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, any mistakes was from me. Wa aqimu salah.